In the 19th century, the railways transformed America. The fastest train in modern America runs from the heart of Washington, D.C., along one of the busiest routes in the country.
Let's run some trains.
Matt Baume explores what the railroads look like today.
Wow. It's probably the coolest ride I've ever had.
My name is Matt Baume. Ever since I was a kid, I've been obsessed with trains. My day job? I work on a railroad in Maine. But this is my dream. To ride the biggest, fastest, most awesome trains in history.
The busiest passenger rail line in America. The Northeast Corridor stretches for over 700 kilometers from DC to Boston. These rails transport more passengers more often than any other rail line in the country. Amtrak does nearly half of all its business here, providing for more than 10 million passengers a year.
Business people who live in this fast-paced environment don't have time to wait around.
The Northeast Corridor features America's only high-speed rail service. The Amtrak's Acela Express. This lightning-fast European-style bullet train links the biggest cities in the U.S.
This bullet train zooms from downtown to downtown up to 150 miles an hour.
The Acela Express has been in operation since the year 2000.
The journey starts here in Washington, D.C.
In the heart of Washington, D.C., America's capital since 1800, sits Union Station.
It takes 6 hours and 43 minutes to get from Washington to Boston on the Acela.
From Washington, D.C., it's northbound for the bright lights of New York City. Then on to South Station in Boston, the Acela's final destination. To maintain the trains, the crew work round the clock at the Ivy City facility in Washington.
This place only services the unique Acela train. Since each Acela train costs $25 million apiece, there's only 20 in existence. Even with just 20 trains, Amtrak still manages 35 Acela routes a day.
The Acela Express operates at full capacity all the time. So at Ivy City High Speed Facility, speed is also of the essence to get trains safe, operational, and back out on the tracks.
There's no turnaround time here. These trains have to be in and right back out pronto. Two dozen craftsmen have less than 4 hours to inspect every inch of this train.
Everything has to be perfect. Unlike a freight train or a normal passenger train, the Acela cannot be taken apart.
This is called a train set. Between each coach is a semi-permanent coupler. It's right in there. It gives the train a very, very tight connection.
The tight connections eliminate the pulling and lurching found in trains with separate carriages. The smoother ride enables Acela passengers to continue working without interruption. But the connected carriages also have a downside.
Because it's kept in one piece, cars can't be broken off for service. If one car has a problem, the entire train has to be pulled with it.
Each Acela train is made up of four business class carriages, a cafeteria, and a first class carriage. To get up to speeds of 240 kilometers an hour, it also needs some extra power.
The Acela's unique engines aren't known as locomotives, they're called power cars.
While standard diesel locomotives can generate over 4,000 horsepower, these can generate up to 6,000 horsepower.
This has more horsepower than any other train in America.
And our train has an engine at both ends, which makes it easier and quicker to turn around and stay on schedule. The energy to turn out 6,000 horsepower comes from above. Heavy-duty wires called catenaries carry electricity over 4 meters above the tracks. To get that electricity into the engine, a conductive metal bar called a pantograph is connected to the roof of the locomotive. When brought into contact with the wires, electricity flows down through the pantograph and into the train. Coy, one of the engineers, needs to inspect this pantograph. The catenaries carry 12,000 volts of electricity each, making Coy's job one of the most dangerous in railway work.
Can't go in there unless they de-energize the catenary to get the key.
All right, man, I trust you. Yeah. I've never been so close to this many volts of electricity. I'm a little nervous.
It's okay.
All right.
The first thing is to avoid electrocution.
Just putting in the grounding rod right now. If any electricity comes in from outside, it's going to hit this, and then he's going to be safe. It's going to short everything out, and the electricity is going to stop here. Now, if these are live, we're about 4 feet from them right now. You get within 3 feet if they're live, what happens?
I won't be getting paid Friday.
Be fried like a bug. Your toenails would melt. Wouldn't be pretty.
Coy also has to work against gravity. At nearly 5 meters above the ground, he needs to wear a safety harness.
And I hope you've never really had to test this thing out.
No, never.
All right. Both power cars in the front and the back have pantographs that'll go up and take electricity out of these wires and make the train go. This checkout part is very important because this is the only way they get power from those wires to the power car.
After the personal safety checks, Coy gets to work. He needs to make sure that the pantograph is safely connected to the train.
This is very important because you don't want these pantographs bouncing around when this train is going 130, 150 miles an hour. Could rip down the catenaries and cause millions of dollars worth of damage.
On top of each pantograph are two carbon strips which help conduct electricity. If these carbon strips break or get worn down, the electricity won't flow and the train won't move.
The catenary doesn't stay in one place on the pantograph. It rubs back and forth as the train goes around curves and goes down the tracks, rubs back and forth and it wears it down. And this one needs to be replaced. Okay, right, there you go, man.
Thank you.
And with that, the inspection's done, the pantograph's all set, and with a good source of electricity, this train's gonna go from DC all the way to Boston.
Washington, DC's Union Station opened in 1908. The station became an integral part of American life during two world wars, transporting nearly 200,000 passengers a day.
This is one of the greatest rail stations in American history.
Today, Washington's Union Station is visited by 32 million people a year. It's the southernmost end of the Northeast Corridor.
From businessmen to tourists to students to your average Joe to politicians, over 90,000 people come through this station every day.
And with air travel getting more expensive and less reliable, this high-speed Acela train is in demand for its reliable service.
This 150-mile-an-hour Lamjet is about to take off. Let's go.
To cover the 700 kilometers from Washington to Boston in less than 7 hours, speeds of up to 150 miles per hour will require full throttle.
We've left Washington, D.C., and we're heading up the Northeast Corridor.
The 10 a.m. high-speed Acela train is racing at top speed to Boston, Massachusetts. Compared to other trains that share the track, the Acela has a completely different feel.
You can feel the acceleration. It's a lot like flying. If you've ever flown in a plane and taken off, this is the feeling I'm having right now in my seat. This is crazy.
A high-speed train is defined as any train that can travel at 200 kilometers or 125 miles an hour or faster. On some stretches, the Acela Express gets up to 240 kilometers an hour.
Wow, this is great. This is insane. I'm sorry. We're going 95 miles an hour right now. Like, within 10 seconds, it's like, boom, 95 miles an hour, 96. This is fantastic. Oh my God. 118 miles an hour. 134 miles an hour.
To maximize safety, Amtrak minimized crossings on the Acela route.
This is the fastest train in North America, 135 miles an hour. Jeez, the kids don't even have a chance to go like this to you, do they?
The Acela shares the track with freight and other passenger trains, all of which are much slower. So the signalers clear the way so the high-speed trains can get to where they need to go.
This is as tough as it gets. There's 4 to 6 tracks, trains going in either direction. Right now we're blistering a regional train right over here on this other track.
Speed limits are critical on a high-speed line. At high speed, any train collision is a recipe for disaster. In September 2006, a German high-speed train hit a maintenance vehicle near Leven. The train was going at 200 kilometers an hour when the collision occurred. Amtrak takes every possible safety precaution to make sure the Acela passengers have a safe journey.
It's impressive how fast this train goes, but what's even more impressive to me is how fast it slows down. It's not only the fastest train in the country as far as speed, but it's also the fastest braking train.
The Acela uses an electric dynamic braking system to ensure a safe, smooth, and speedy stop.
So we're in Baltimore now.
Yes, sir.
We're going to stop and pick some people up and drop some people off.
When the electric brakes are activated, electricity is withdrawn from the train's motors, reversing their direction and slowing the train.
They take the motor that gives you the traction to accelerate the train, and they do it in reverse.
Instead of accelerating the train with the motors, it reverses the motors.
Right.
And makes the train slow down.
The electric brakes are also energy efficient. When the traction motors are reversed, the electric power is returned through the pantograph back into the catenaries to be used by other trains.
We're putting the dynamic brake and we're putting electricity back into the overhead wire.
So you're actually taking power from the train and feeding it back into the wires?
When you're doing the dynamic braking.
And then plug-in. Another train will come along and use that?
Mm-hmm. It just puts it back up in there.
Now, how economical and green is that? This is a green train.
The electric power is only part of what allows this Acela to reach up to 240 kilometers an hour. When a train goes into a bend, an inward force called the centripetal force pushes towards the center of the curve, pulling the train in. An effect best seen when a motorbike leans into a corner. The problem for most trains is that they can't lean, so they have to slow down instead. But the Acela can tilt. The ability to tilt into bends is a major factor in high-speed travel.
There's the tilt. We're going around this curve. Cars behind us are tilting.
Once the train gets above 96 kilometers an hour, the tilt system kicks in and the cars lean into the curves, allowing the Acela to keep going without slowing down.
Here's how it works. Each car has a tilt control center. This is where they hook the laptop up to check and calibrate the tilt of the train. Whoa, and we're tilting. Wow. When this train's moving, though, you would never notice a thing. But right now, we're stationary. You can really feel the rock.
The tilt system gets information from a gyroscope at the front of the train. This tells each carriage's individual tilt mechanism what angle to tilt at as the train leans into the curve.
As you can see right here, there are hydraulic cylinders underneath the train that make it tilt.
Because of the advanced tilt control, no one will ever spill a drink on this train. For the passengers sitting down, it's a smooth and comfortable ride.
Even though the passengers don't notice the bends, the engineer is aware of every inch of these tracks.
But you still had to slow down for this curve here. We went from 110 to 105 for this curve, but still with this train, it's only a 5 mile an hour difference where a regional train would have to slow down.
Taking curves at high speeds requires the engineer to have skill and an understanding of the tilt mechanism.
He doesn't have the tilt, so he can't pull it off like we do.
Plus, he's not as good as me.
You have to have nerves of steel to be in that seat right there.
We're approaching Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
30th Street Station.
Coming into a place like this with the electric power units is a lot different than diesel, too, where there's no fumes.
Right.
This is another place where the electric engines really help out. And there are a lot of people here getting ready to get on this train. So from here, we're about an hour from New York?
55 minutes to an hour, yes.
Wow.
The other major obstacle to full capacity high speed comes from below, the rails themselves. Much of the Northeast Corridor track dates back to the 1800s, and though sturdy, it's not all high-speed spec.
Between Washington, D.C. and Boston, there are over 300 speed changes. It's up and down all the way.
In 1997, Amtrak began to replace wooden ties along the Northeast Corridor with sturdier steel-reinforced concrete ones. There's only one way to make this stretch ready for a high-speed train: concrete ties. On high-speed routes, sturdier tracks equal faster trains.
Every year, the railroads use up to 2 million concrete railroad ties. And this is where they're made, the Rockwood plant in Denver. Every day, 130 tons of cement, 450 tons of sand, and 600 tons of rock get delivered to this plant. This is where it starts. They dump the aggregate into the silo. It goes up that conveyor belt. You can see it going in right there. It goes into the plant. This 500-foot belt takes the raw material at 90 feet to the top of that tower. The concrete is mixed in these two mixers right here. The mixed concrete is dropped into that hopper, and then it's taken over to the forms.
Each mile of rail uses 3,000 ties, each set 2 feet apart. So on one set of tracks between DC and Boston, there are 1.3 million rail ties.
This is where they pour the concrete. It's called the form. It's like a cake mold. Concrete goes right in there. It's got 18 of these wires, just like piano wires. They're so tight, it's to reinforce the tie. They even grease it. The concrete goes from the hopper into the forms. Once the concrete is dried, they have to cut the ties out.
The blades they use to cut are coated in resin, so they're super tough. But even these ultra-tough blades last only 90 minutes before they need to be replaced.
There are 108 steel rods to strengthen these ties. They go through the length of the form. With 18 rods per tie, every time that blade comes down, it cuts through them. You see, the edge of that blade is red hot. Keep it cool, and the dust down, they spray it with water. Once they've made the cut, they have to get the ties out. It's just like popping a cake out of a baking tray. Here's how they do it. Bam! There's your railroad tie. Just like a nice, warm piece of birthday cake. And that, my friends, is what makes the Acela run so smooth.
Though only 10% of rail ties in America are made of concrete, their use is increasing by the day, especially along the Northeast Corridor.
Let me ask you this, Bill. What's it like to go from running a train 125 miles an hour, you get off work, and you get into your car and you have to drive down the Interstate 65?
I still have a little heavy foot.
Speeding tickets?
I've got a few of those too. You know, like you say, you're doing 125 predominantly all day long, and you get in your car and you seem like you're standing still.
Operating this Acela train isn't for everyone. You have to have nerves of steel to do this. as we blast along at 135 miles an hour. The fastest train on the continent.
It's 11 a.m. and the Acela is making great time, which is vital on arrival at America's busiest rail station in one of the biggest cities in the world. We're speeding up the Northeast Corridor on the fastest train in America, Amtrak's Acela Express. Around 100 kilometers south of New York City, on our way to Boston, the Acela is flying.
I was flying into to D.C. yesterday, and I could see this line, and I could see an Acela train on it. And the plane was beating it, but it wasn't beating it by that much.
Really?
Yeah. That was impressive just to see it from that angle. Gives you an idea how fast these things really are.
Although the flight time between Washington and New York is about an hour, the Acela is still the fastest way to get door-to-door from downtown D.C. to downtown Manhattan.
Most of your airports in the area of New York are outside the city, so you got to take a cab or a bus or subway or something. The train takes you right into New York City.
Though air travel has dominated over the last 30 years, the Northeast Corridor track system has been in place since the 1830s. At first, many small railways operated the lines between cities, but consolidation beckoned. By 1885, the Pennsylvania Railroad had swallowed up over 800 smaller lines and emerged as the most powerful railway in America. At its height, the PRR controlled 10,000 miles of track and was the largest public corporation in the world. The Pennsylvania Railroad's success was powered by steam. To see what had to be done to keep steam engines moving, there's no better place than a railway museum.
Between the 1830s and 1950s, the United States produced over 177,000 steam locomotives. Burning coal heats water that creates steam that powers the locomotive. Everyone's seen those black and white movies with steam billowing out of the locomotive. Well, all that's coming out of the smoke box.
And one of the most important jobs on a steam engine is to keep the smoke box clear. If the smoke box isn't clear, the steady flow of steam will slow and the engine won't run.
This is a collection point for the exhaust coming from the firebox and the used steam that comes up through the cylinders. And it gets exhausted right up through the smokestack.
And that makes the chuff, chuff, chuff sound?
Right.
The harder the engine works, the more it chuffs and louder
right.
it gets.
And the more it drafts your fire.
Keeping the steam flowing is called drafting. Steam engines only work when there's a constant flow of steam to power the pistons.
If you ever wondered what the nose and the inside of a steam locomotive looks like, you're about to find out right now. Wow, that's heavy. Ugh, it smells like my brother's old apartment in there. Whew. If they didn't have this screen, the bigger cinders would get through, the really huge ones, go through the smokestack, and it'd be just like a missile. Could cause a forest fire or even burn somebody's house down if it hit their house.
When used steam leaves through the smokestack, a vacuum is created in the smoke box. This vacuum sucks new steam from the boiler into the smoke box, keeping the steam moving and the engine running.
That is one heck of a chimney there.
The next step would be to hose it out.
Okay. All right, this looks like it's the hose, huh? Mm-hmm. All right, so just kind of... Mm-hmm. Whoa.
Whoa.
Oh! Sorry about that.
I think you did a good job.
Thanks. Well, the next thing for you to do is to climb in there on your belly, give it an inspection.
Belly down and inspect the entire smoke box.
Well, that doesn't sound like something that I'm qualified to do. So you know what? I'll let you have at it. I'm out of here.
Well, I'm going in.
All right. Good luck.
Maintenance on the Northeast Corridor is still the railway's biggest priority. There are thousands of miles of electric cable running up and down the coast, and all of that cable needs to be maintained. That's where Amtrak's catenary maintenance crews come in. Each catenary carries over 12,000 volts of electricity, so before any work can be done, the power needs to be cut off. Amtrak can't afford to cut off power on the entire route, so a network of insulators separate the line into smaller sections. In this way, power can be shut off in one section for work to be done, while trains continue to run along the rest of the line.
Each section is separated by an insulator. That way workers can come out, they can work on a section of the catenary without getting electrocuted.
If the insulators fail, there'd be nothing to stop the lethal flow of electricity into this section. This insulator needs changing so these guys can do their job and get home in one piece. Keeping the insulators in good working order is vital to maintaining these wires so the Acela can run as quickly and safely as possible.
They change the insulators, they flip the switch, the lines are hot, the job's done. You have to be a train nut to work on these trains, there's no doubt about it.
It is a job where you have to like what you do.
And you know what? It's pretty darn cool to say, I've run the fastest train on the continent. I'm an Acela engineer. How many people can say that?
Amtrak's looking for engineers, you know? You put a resume in, you might be able to get this job.
We're approaching a tunnel, which goes under the Hudson River and into the Big Apple.
Next stop, New York, under the Hudson into Penn Station.
Known as the North River Tunnel, it opened in 1910. It operates at almost 100% capacity during peak hours. And while it has seen thousands of trains in its lifetime, it has never seen anything else as fast as the Acela.
We're under the Hudson River right now. How far does this tunnel go?
It's roughly 3 miles long.
Wow, 3 miles under the Hudson River. And this tunnel is tight. Barely enough room for us to fit through here.
I don't know what we're going to do when a train comes the other way.
I can see the light at the end of the tunnel here. And when we come out, we're going to be in New York City, the Big Apple.
Back in 1902, all the trains traveling through New York City were powered by steam engines, and the Park Avenue Tunnel in Manhattan was one of the most dangerous routes. It was initially built to reduce pollution on the streets, but the soot and smoke made visibility in the tunnel almost nil. On the 8th of January 1902, a White Plains Express train entered the tunnel. It was a freezing cold day, and the thick smoke from the steam engine made the tunnel pitch black. The train's engineer never saw the stop signal. At top speed, he plowed the White Plains Express into the rear of a stopped commuter train. 15 people died, and 36 more were injured. It's the worst train crash in New York City's history. Since 1920, all trains on the Northeast Corridor have run on electricity.
Wow, unreal. We just came out of the tunnel and...
You're in the city of New York.
We're in New York, and I can't even count how many tracks are here.
New York is the busiest passenger rail hub in America. New Yorkers account for more than two-thirds of all the country's rail passengers.
Wow, it looks like spaghetti. These tracks. Not used to this. And here we are in Penn Station, the Big Apple, New York City.
The traffic in and out of Penn Station is non-stop day and night.
I'm in New York's Penn Station, the busiest train station in America. Amtrak alone serves 8 million people a year here. The original Penn Station was the jewel in the Pennsylvania Railroad's crown.
In 1910, the Pennsylvania Railroad began regular train services in and out of Penn Station. The original pink granite structure took up two city blocks and covered 8 acres. Its main waiting room was the largest indoor space in New York. During the Second World War, passenger numbers soared, but by the late 1950s, aeroplanes began to replace rail travel. Today, just the lower levels of Penn Station remain, but they still see more traffic than any other station in America.
Of the 1,365 trains that run through here every weekday,
35 of them are the cream of the crop. That's the Acela.
Amtrak needs to juggle hundreds of trains at a time and keep them on schedule.
Amtrak controls all the trains in the region right here. For the Acela, every minute counts, so they have priority over every train on that board. If you look at the tracks that are green, that means there's a route cleared for the train that's coming. Behind it, the track turns red. That means the system's not going to let any other trains in there.
Every 90 seconds, 1,000 passengers go through Penn Station. Absolute precision is required to keep all these trains moving.
Right here are the train dispatchers. It's their job to control every train on the Northeast Corridor.
That board represents 98.6 miles of track leading in and out of Penn Station.
There are 11 platforms and 21 tracks in Penn Station. If someone down there makes a mistake, it's going to be a train crash. It's going to be a tragedy. And it never happens on the Northeast Corridor. And there's so many trains, so you know these guys are down here doing their job.
The tracks inside the station are among the most used in the world, so Amtrak constantly needs to replace them. Building new track takes time, and shutting down some of the world's busiest rail platforms every couple of days would be a nightmare. So the tracks are built off-site at the Sunnyside Yard in Queens.
You know the section of track you had on your model railroad when you were a kid and just snapped together? Well, that's what these guys are building right here. First, they lay out the ties 19 and a half inches apart. Next, they put the tie plates in. They use these giant wood screws here, probably the biggest wood screw I've ever seen. Drop it right in there. Next, they take the rail, and then they lay it onto the tie plates. Each rail is 34 feet long. That's 1,541 pounds. You don't want that dropping on your foot. Those ties weigh up to 500 pounds each, and to move them, they use the tie tongs. Next, they line up the ties with those little white lines right there. Then, they hammer in the tie clips. That's what holds the rail in place. These guys are building a switch.
It's a point where one track diverges into two tracks. It's what allows trains to go to different places.
This part right here is the most important piece. It's called the frog. This is actually where the tracks diverge. There's the finished switch right there. You can see where the two tracks diverge up there at the frog. They're putting the last rail in right now. They just have to clip it in. It's going to be ready to go. To hold the rails together, they stick these join bars in. It secures them. Holds it together like a vice grip, makes the rail nice and smooth.
The assembled track can now be transported into Penn Station, where it's ready to be dropped into place. With new passengers on board, we're ready to leave New York's Penn Station and get on our way to Boston.
Owning these rails allows Amtrak to make improvements to trains like the Acela. This train has to run. Over 3.2 million people a year won't make it to work on time.
For the early electric trains, getting out of New York was a nightmare.
In 1909, when the Pennsylvania Railroad was building their line north of New York, they ran into a problem, how to cross the Hutchinson River.
The Hutchinson River reaches up to 24 meters wide and used to serve as a main artery for cargo and supply ships going to and from New York's harbors.
The answer was to build the Pelham Bay Bridge.
Heavy boat traffic required a drawbridge. Open to traffic in 1909, the Pelham Bay Bridge worked well at first. But the dawn of electric trains and overhead catenaries presented a new problem.
The problem with the drawbridge is, what are you going to do with the catenaries? Those are the wires up there that give power to the train. The answer was to spring-load the wires. When this part of the bridge goes up right here, the catenaries separate right there.
The separated lines allow the bridge to open and let boat traffic pass underneath.
Let's see this thing in action. Wow,
Look at that. Now that is pretty cool right there. You see how it disconnected? The wires are sagging down over there. Wow, that's pretty cool. All right, there you can see it's coming up right there. Check that out. And the wires, they're coming down. And it feels kind of dangerous standing out here. I'm a little bit close to these wires. Then you can see the springs over here, they're compressing.
Once the catenaries above the bridge are disconnected, the flow of electricity stops. But with this much power, the crew can't be too careful.
They're not connected to the power system right now, but there still could be 1,000 volts of residual electricity in there. So we'll stay away. They're compressed right now. You can see them, they're sagging a little bit. As soon as there's tension on the catenaries, it's gonna tighten up and those springs are just gonna go boing, they're gonna go right back out. They're gonna decompress. If it wasn't for those springs, you couldn't have catenaries on a drawbridge.
Once the boats have passed, they have to put the bridge back together again.
Here it comes, it's coming back down nice and easy now. You can see the catenaries are gonna come right back together right there. Here it comes. Let's run some trains.
With a clear path, we're about to go faster than any other train in America. Amtrak's Acela Express is on its last leg from Washington, D.C. to Boston.
The Acela is about to reach its top speed of 150 miles an hour.
On this 54.5 kilometer stretch through Rhode Island and Massachusetts, the combination of concrete ties, tight new catenaries, and the tilt mechanism allow the Acela to reach its top speed.
I'm digging my fingernails into the dashboard here. This is officially the fastest I've ever been on a train.
The modern catenaries are tighter and straighter than the old ones from the 1930s, allowing for maximum contact between the catenary and the pantograph. Maximum contact equals maximum speed.
150 miles an hour is the fastest speed any land vehicle is allowed in North America.
High-speed trains like the Acela are often called bullet trains because of their sleek aerodynamic design. The Acela's engine consists of a single lightweight shell, making it lighter and faster than other trains. But back in the early 1900s, before the single shell body was invented, trains were made of hundreds of steel pieces. And holding the hundreds of steel parts together were rivets.
Back in the day when they were building these old steam engines, everything was held together by rivets. Now, riveting is a fine art. Let's go over here and see how it's done. This furnace right here is where they heat the rivets. It's 2,000 degrees.
What we're gonna do is we're gonna form the head on the other side. And then when that rivet cools, it shrinks together. All those pieces of material makes a very strong joint.
I think this one's about ready.
Using the rivet gun, the softened metal is molded into the required shape.
You do have to be very careful.
So it's like a bullet then?
Yes, it is. That's exactly what happens when it comes out without nothing there. It comes out like a bullet.
But before working on the actual train body, practice is required. First, the scalding hot rivet is hammered into place. Then, using the rivet gun, the other end of the rivet is hammered into shape.
I think I'm ready to try the real thing.
Some steam train bodies needed 5,000 rivets to hold them together, and just one badly fitted rivet could cause it to break apart.
Don't pull that trigger until you're dead on it tight.
Right.
Listen for the hammer hits.
Peter's coming in.
Using a rivet gun requires lots of strength and a steady hand.
I'll tell you what. Excellent job.
Excellent job. Is that gonna stay?
That's it. She's a keeper.
Older locomotives were heavy and bulky, but with modern construction methods and lightweight designs, modern trains can reach speeds beyond a steam engineer's wildest dreams.
This is like riding a train on a racetrack.
The Acela is America's fastest train, but it's not the fastest train in the world. In Europe, high-speed bullet trains like France's TGV run at speeds of over 300 kilometers an hour. The Shinkansen in Japan rockets up to 350 kilometers an hour. And in December 2003, the Maglev recorded the fastest train speed in history, 581 kilometers an hour. Though the Acela's top speed was 241 kilometers an hour, or 150 miles per hour, it could go faster.
These power cars could go up to 200 miles an hour if they were allowed.
But the combination of heavy traffic on the line, old tracks, and wires hold the train back.
Until Amtrak is able to build a dedicated line, this is probably the fastest any train is going to be able to go in the United States.
In other countries, overwhelming demand paved the way for high-speed rail. A high-speed rail network in the US seems far off, but the possibilities are breathtaking. The fastest trains in the world can safely travel at over 480 kilometers an hour. At that speed, you'd be able to get from New York to Los Angeles in only 10 hours. From Chicago to Houston would take less than 4 hours. And this Acela train could blast nonstop from Washington to Boston in under 2 hours. In such a world, rail could surpass air travel in both popularity and efficiency because of its enormous passenger capacity and its direct access to city centers.
What's better than blasting by a beach on a nice sunny day like today? Because it's beautiful. It's beautiful out there. All right, we're pulling into Boston. I'm gonna get off, I'm gonna get on the Downeaster, and I'm gonna go home. You've got 150 miles an hour. Never done that before. Some of the smoothest track I've ever ridden over in my life. This is like a homecoming for me. Boston is where I started my railroad career. I spent a lot of time in Boston. The Celtics play here. This is like my home city, man. Next stop, South Station.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are now arriving at South Station, Boston. This is the final stop of the train.
I'm done with my business on the Northeast Corridor. I just have to catch the train back to Maine, and I'm on my way home.